They were only designed to get one response. And surely anybody who had seen them must realise that that's the case. And I know I'm wrong on that, I have no doubts whatsoever. All the people they are asking for is something called transparent democracy, and for their views to be taken on board. And I'm sure it's strong enough, and it's going to benefit the Tees Valley in this town. There's no, it's mentioned about being fleet of foot and getting stuck in this hasn't suddenly come out of the ether. This has been planned for a very long time. I think as it stands, we're in great danger of being seen as totally undemocratic, as being seen as not wanting to listen to the views of people. I realise that business yet again. I mean, we seem to see it so often in this chamber and in this building where business, their views are taken paramount and override the views of people. I think people in this town, especially, have a right to a fair trial with regard to consultation. That's all people are asking for. None of them, as I read the questions, none of them are saying anything at all that's derogatory about the idea of a combined authority. What they're saying is they want a fair consultation. By any stretch of the imagination, what's gone on has not been a fair consultation. And if we continue on with this unfair consultation, it's time to return the shames of local authorities.
Part of the issue I would have with the Leader of the Council's answer is that it had very little to do with the question being asked. At least 75% of it was an attempt to convince people that a combined authority is a good idea. I don't know why you're bothering trying to convince people. You're not asking them the question. Now, my issue is, combined authority, if there was a referendum tomorrow on it, I would vote for it. I generally speaking, like and support the concepts of greater devolution to local areas. It probably isn't feasible to devolve significant power down to local authorities the size of Hartlepool. So some mechanism has to be developed to allow that to happen. I would point out that I question sometimes the will of national government to do that and whether it's not some sense of red herring. And people will know that where there is significant agenda, they're actually insisting on elected mayors being introduced into the area. Irony indeed, I would have thought. Moreover, I'm entirely in favour of anything that dilutes the powers of the group opposite in Hartlepool, and perhaps the white authority by hell's do that with this. But the key issue here is not whether it's a good idea or whether it's a bad idea. I know to the horror of many members opposite, part of what I do as head of politics in my day job is teach young people about democratic processes in the United Kingdom. And under the module that talks about referenda, it suggests a number of reasons why referendums should be held. One of them is when the political system has failed, more about that perhaps later. But another reason is where there is a fundamental shift in where the political sovereignty that belongs to these people over here and not to us to make decision lies. My view is very clear. A combined authority does do that. And worse still, anybody who seriously thinks they can stand up in this chamber and say that a combined authority is not the first stage of joint working across the Tees Valley when those devolved powers come and the decision making happens in Middlesbrough is quite honestly out of their mind. Clearly, we are seeing it right around the country that decisions are being centralised so that much more significant powers can be devolved down to them. Now, that may be the right thing. But the people who get to decide whether that happens are not the people in this chamber, it's the people of Hartlepool who decide if that happens.
Yeah, it's more a question of clarification to Chief Solicitor really rather than trying to debate. That's okay, or it is on the issue of the end. I missed what the Council Leader said with regard to a referendum tied in with the
later in the business of the meeting, obviously there is that certain of the motion where you were formally forced about whether you have a referendum or not. The key thing for me actually is the timing of that referendum and the nature of whether you vote heavy to and all whether it's actually ballot box to catch your vote or whether by portal board. And whether you reserve business to progress this for electoral age or below that, so that I choose to decide. It is a question actually of practicalities at the end of the day. We will be running obviously the UK parliamentary election, which will double the turnout in this actually in previous elections. 2010 was the shape of the 60%, which this actually increased basically the turnout for local elections, again basically by 50%. We will be running actually say UK parliamentary, local and potentially parish elections. We'll be having the count by way of primacy or general election first, before the second half of the polling morning by the local elections. Particularly to run another poll, say a parish poll at the afternoon, so we could actually start counting basically late in the night around this actually a referendum. So I don't think it is practical really to run this referendum on the 17th May. If members basically decide to boost a referendum, we will hold that referendum as soon as it's reasonably practicable. I am to say at this stage, caution will basically happen on the 17th May.
Okay, we will now go on to the next question, question 5. News members for the Chair of Finance and Policy Committee. Figures about the attendance of councils and meetings are starkly different. The council is attending over 129 meetings in the Headland and Harbour Ward to 37 for the Staple Ward. Can the public have a comment on the level of the basic allowance for councillors of Hartlepool Borough Council in relation to meetings attended?
As per the council's constitution, members are entitled to claim certain hours listed in recognition of time devoted by them to their work as a councillor. The basic allowance covers attendance of formal and informal meetings of the council, as well as meetings with constituents, such as through ward surgeries. A special responsibility allowance is payable to those councillors who undertake specified additional duties as defined in the members' allowance scheme. That scheme is fully compliant with the local authority's members' allowance regulation from 2003, which also takes into account the recommendations made by an independent remuneration panel to council. The basic allowance has been £5,825 since the 1st of April 2013. Prior to that, the basic allowance had been frozen for 4 years at £5,767. From the 1st of January 2015, the basic allowance is £5,953, which will remain in place until at least the 31st of March 2016, in line with the pay award for our staff. This will be significantly less than the North East average of £8,965. And we ignore the highest basic allowance in the region of 13,300 and less than the amount recommended by the independent remuneration panel of 6,517 from the 1st of April 2015. Attendances are published once again to coincide with the publication of allowances. Following a Freedom of Information request, details of attendances will be dated the request for the current municipal year. Are also available on the council's website. Attendances by councillors do vary considerably, and publication of such attendances may not reflect the extent of their work as a ward councillor. Not all attendances are recorded for publication, and as such, some members may fail at committee meetings and not an integral part of their role as a councillor, although the basic allowance does cover such attendances.
We're now into debate. Okay, there's no debate, we're still in time, we'll move on to question 8 on the order. Mr. Mayor, this is from Mr. Graham Meeser, the Chair of the Neighbourhood Services Committee. Regarding the recent banning of seacoal collection in Seacoal Ruby, the collection of seacoal is part of our history and heritage and has been going on since the 1800s. Will the Council please agree a sensible way forward on this issue? In order to take this forward, will the council please agree to approach the Crown Estate Commissioners to implement the second variation of the lease, allowing the collection of C-code during agreed times. In addition to this, will they also agree to undertake a risk assessment on allowing legitimate beach access for the C-coders, and following this, approach their own insurers to see if they would subsequently cover such activity. Furthermore, our C-coders already have their own public liability insurance of £5 million for collection of C-code from the beach. Why then does our council seem fit to ban them?
On Monday the 19th of January 2015, the Neighbours Service Committee was presented with a legal recommendation to ensure that the council was not in contravention of its lease agreement with the Crown Estate. The lease agreement prohibits the driving of mechanically propelled vehicles across the foreshore, excepting those covered by a later exemption. It was agreed by the committee that the barrier on the foreshore at Station Lane should be closed and that all other vehicle barriers were secured. However, at this meeting, the committee also agreed to pursue the idea of adopting a scheme which enables stakeholders to legitimately access the beach with vehicles. The removal of stakeholders under such a scheme would also assist with defensive operations. For clarification, unauthorised vehicle access has been prohibited at this time, and not the actual collecting of C-code. An application was made to the Crown Estate on the 18th of December 2014 for a new amendment to the lease, which is more prescriptive than the former, but will allow HBC to still control vehicular access. The amendment is as follows. Notwithstanding Clause 3, Section 8 of the lease, the Commissioner grants to the tenants the right to permit the pass and repass of mechanically propelled vehicles which require access to statutory functions or for monitoring and maintenance purposes. It is considered that if this variation is approved, then further consideration could be given to adopting an official mechanism for allowing the collection of C-code. Health and safety and public liability will be fundamental to any future decisions made which allow vehicular access to the beach regardless of access or activity. As access by vehicles is not permitted under the terms and conditions of the lease agreement with the Crown Estate, C-code vehicles are effectively accessing the land without permission. The council is advised that this practice negates any insurance, but would also mean that any person taking a motorised vehicle onto the beach is in contravention of the Road Traffic Act 1988 and may face prosecution by the police. The Neighbourhood Services Committee has agreed to pursue the idea of adopting a scheme which enables stakeholders to legitimately access the beach with vehicles. A working group consisting of officers from the council and stakeholders has been set up and meetings have been scheduled to progress matters in this regard.
Okay. We now on to debate. Any debate on this matter? Councillor Chaplin.
Just an observation, Mr. Chairman. I would think at least twice, sometimes three times a week, I walk on various beaches in Hartlepool, and I've done it for decades. I see people with vehicles collecting C-code, I would say almost on a daily basis. So I think we really need to get ready to ensure, and I'm glad what's been said. But the reality is, whether we've got a legal right to be on the beach or whatever, people still collecting C-code, it's still creating employment. I accept that that's, you know, that's not come here, I don't know. But I think we need to make sure that we can allow C-code traders access to the beach, responsible licensed C-code partners from C-code traders, and make sure that it works, because as it is now, the ban is not the point.
Okay, any further debate on this matter? No? Okay, thank you very much to the members of the public who have put forward. So first of all, I will take the minutes of the 6th of February, and we agree on the minutes. Sorry, is it an accuracy issue?
I wanted to check whether it's been this accuracy issue, or if it could be a question or if it is possible.
Could you identify what it is then, please?
If I can explain, maybe that will help. Okay. Following the response to my question to Councillor King, I did receive clarification on the solicitor conference before.
Sorry, this will come under questions under a minute.
Sorry, Chair.
Okay. Can we agree those minutes, members? Okay. Councillor Riddle.
Thanks. Okay. Follow the answer to my question. Basically pursued that question from the solicitor and the CEO, and I did gain ultimately quite a bit of yes to the request, which wasn't received on the mic. So it's just really a request to identify the person and clarify that principle to find yes.
Okay, but my understanding is the minutes are to reflect the meeting and not for what has happened after the meeting. So therefore, I'll seek further advice on that.
Yeah, Chair, that is correct. Obviously, it's the accuracy of the minutes on the evening. I mean, certainly, in the attendance, we need to be on accuracy, not matters transpiring outside of the meeting.
Well, can I ask the minutes to recognise the minutes that have been requested in the meeting? I think request that I got a clarification.
Yes, that's fine. Councillor Bradley.
Thanks, Chair. On minute 120 on page 6 of the 5th of February minutes, reference is made to my request, actually on the previous meeting, around minimum pricing. Can I first of all, for asking a question, publicly thank the licensing committee and Louise Wallace, who, as always, is a first-rate job, who has written to us all this week. And pointed out that as a result of that debate, we will now be putting minimum unit pricing in our draft licensing policy. This could tell us about later this year. I think that's an important step and a victory for common sense when it comes to that more serious issues. Louise went on to point out in her letter that the issue around inviting representatives from Manchester, who are looking at this issue, and perhaps, as I said before, have a different legal view about local introduction, is going to be dealt with by the Health and Wellbeing Board, because they've been tasked with this issue further. What it doesn't say is whether we are going to invite representatives from Manchester to get that feedback as requested. So my question is, Linda Chair, the Health and Wellbeing Board, can we put that invitation out to both elected members and legal officers and whoever else is involved in that initiative in Manchester, so that we can hear from them first hand how they're pursuing it, so we can get an idea of ourselves how we can pursue it.
Mr. Hopper, I'm happy to answer that. Okay, thank you. Okay, so any further matters on the minutes? Okay. Okay, we'll now move on to matters of the minutes of the 16th of February. Again,
we're
dealing with accuracy
issues.
Councillor
Jeffrey. Thanks, Mr. Chairman. On page 5, third paragraph down, following the number of interruptions and procedure from proceedings from the public gallery, the chair adjourned the meeting, and left the meeting. So allow order to be restored, Mr. Chairman. Then that meeting was certainly recorded by the members of the public. And you didn't adjourn the meeting, Mr. Chairman, you actually closed the meeting. So I'm just like to say, that's the reality of what happened.
I'm ringing the bar so it's a death.
What is the issue?